My name is Jonathon Meades, and this series is called Further Abroad. It's set in a distant present, in a land where there's no such word as ordinary, and where every...
And braes are bonny where early falls the dew, and it's there that Annie Laurie gied me her promise true, gied me her promise true, which ne'er forgot.
Scotland, home of iron brew, home of heavy, home of Highland Park. Scotland, where the hills are forever alive to the importunate refrain of William Atos Macabalassi. Scotland, which gave the world Nicholas Fairbairn and the Bay City Rollers. Scotland, which also gave the world the Soccer Hall Sandwich. But despite these attractions, some of which are ephemeral, some of which are enduring, nothing has put Scotland on the map the way that golf has. Golf is Scotland's very special gift to the world. But none of this is Scotland. This is Surrey. St. Andrews, Muirfield, Gleneagles, they all have their twin towns, their triplet landscapes, their dependencies. It is not generally acknowledged that Scotland, which is still part of the Union, has its own colonies, and that the map of Surrey should be stained with tartan to signify its colonial status. Golf has created a type of landscape that's peculiar to itself, a Scottish landscape of pine, birch, heath, heather. It's a landscape that's adored by animals, light entertainers, and mushrooms. It's a sort of pretend countryside, which also happens to be a pretend Scotland. The landscape of this game, shrouded in mundane mysteries, has been determined not just by this Caledonian factor, by this pseudo-Scottishness. It has also been determined by delusions of aristocratic or plutocratic grandeur. Here at Moor Park, the course really is the parkland that surrounded a great house. It was laid out by Capability Brown. This is what the majority of subsequent purpose-built courses attempted to emulate. This manufactured countryside is all pretense, all artifice. It suggests that it is as old as the hills, but the hills are not that old. They were dug and molded by cheap labor only 200 years ago. Mania for classification and for hierarchy is manifest in the way that certain activities, such as, say, hunting and shooting, are deemed to be sports, i.e. officer-class entertainments, while others, such as darts or soccer, are reckoned to be games. Now, if we follow this entirely arbitrary distinction, golf, it must be concluded, is a game, It's rather like outdoor billiards, a still ball hit with a special instrument. But unlike billiards or croquet or snooker, you can't mess up your opponent's chances. You are essentially playing against yourself. In that regard, it's like some kind of field event, rather like shot putting, actually.
But it has advantages over both kinds of endeavour. You don't need the brain of a tactician, and you don't need the body of an athlete. One begins to understand its appeal. It belongs to the Jurassic age of hobbies.
It's a game. But in one absolutely elemental regard, it apes sport. It apes hunting and shooting. Golf is played on nothing so vulgar as a court or a pitch or a green glazed table. Golf is conducted on a course, which pretends to be the sort of countryside across which the unspeakable pink gallop, across which the 12 bores march.
Golf takes this terrain and subdues it with such urban devices as lawn and sandpit. And how wonderfully green, how cosmetically green these lawns are. They're like delicate mucous membrane protected by stubble. And there are so many of them. These courses are everywhere.
Golf has affected the appearance of this country to an extent that's unparalleled by any other sport or game.
Golf has so much invested in it. I don't mean just money, though that's a great part of it. It has so many desires, so many needs, so many fictions attached to it, that it has been a more potent force in planning than planning ever was. I'm not referring to the entirely rectitudinous deals struck on golf courses by councillors, developers and so on. What I mean is that Surrey developments such as St George's Hill and Wentworth are the true parents of this country's subsequent suburbs. And they were created by and are dependent upon golf. And everywhere you see a golf course, you'll find a house like this, inhabited, well, likely as not, by an uncounseled victim of the game that wants to be a sport.
There are some golfing experiences that one suffers as a golf widow that you simply have to blank out of your mind. All these things are quite true. I mean, he can't sue me for them. What can he do? Divorce me? Anyway, we went to a restaurant one evening, and he'd been playing golf all afternoon. I had my first child, Sophie, with me. So we met at, rendezvoused at the restaurant, me with the carry cot and Sophie. Guy had this appalling game. He was so distressed. His swing didn't work. And, you know, it was all, you know, his Uncle Peter had done something. It was all, anyway, there was a whole lot of bad feeling. We sat through the whole dinner, him boring, Sophie and I, to the point where I said, no, I'll go to the pub, you pay the bill, and I'll see you down at the Cross Keys. So Sophie and I marched off. It's a good 10-minute walk. We left, when we'd arrived, we'd left, put Bertie in the carry cot under the table, and he was asleep. 20 minutes after I'd sort of got to the Cross Keys, Guy arrived. He'd remembered the dog, but no Bertie. He'd just left him under a table in the restaurant because he was so distressed about his game, just completely forgotten a newborn child. Now, in London, we could have lost him just like that. I mean, I think little blonde things sell for lots.
Golf's appetite for land is boundless, and it's spendthrift with it. It apparently takes about 3 hours to play a round of golf. Now, compare that with the amount of space it takes to play 3 hours of poker in. Golf is greedy.
Within the area confined by the M25, the London Orbital Motorway, there are 100 golf courses. Golfers have determined our surroundings and have bullied us into an acceptance of them as some sort of norm, in a way that no socceroo, or on the other hand, no animal killer possibly could.
And where there is a course, they let you know about it. They let you know about their influence.
Going out onto one of these courses allows the player to take possession of the landscape, to wander through it with the proprietorial air of some Georgian grandee. This shared delusion is not what they talk about in the bar. They may not even admit it to themselves, but it's there. And were it to rise to the surface, one would be faced by the possibility of golfers swapping their current uniform for some reprise of 18th century kit. But of course, our enthusiasm for the old is qualified. Anyone who designed a car that looked like a stagecoach would be considered one letter short of an alphabet. Yet architects who practice analogous archaisms are reckoned to be playing with a full deck. I'll go further. They're reckoned to have created the ultimate in desirability.
The characteristic habitation of the late 20th century Westerner is the suburb. Not the city, certainly not the countryside. This seems to me indisputable, yet it's something that many Britons are loath to own to. The British suburb, in contrast with, say, the Spanish or the Belgian suburb, pretends not to be a suburb. It aspires to be a village.
We're very fortunate living here because our lawn stretches right down onto the fairway. So when you look around at all and that kind of thing, you might be well in the depths of the country.
Oh, yeah. It's a nice shot.
It's a beauty. He's right by the pin. Oh. Well, I don't mind a bit somebody who hits his ball into the garden on the middle of the lawn and he comes and collects it. But the other day I saw a chap who was ferreting about in the bushes and I said, what on earth are you doing? And he said, well, I'm looking for my ball. Mm-hmm. So I said to him, now look, this is private property. I said, would you mind going out and going back on the golf course? And this is what happens sometimes.
But there was a memorable occasion when we were playing bridge and windows were wide open. It was a lovely sunny day like this. And suddenly, to our amazement, a golf ball whistled past our heads in the drawing room and went right across to the other side of the room.
Golf and suburbia are mutually dependent. The inhabitants of these high suburban houses, which are built on fairways and which are approached over the bodies of a squad of sleeping policemen, apparently believe that they are actually in the country. The houses are falsely bucolic. The most extreme manifestations of this bogus rusticity are brimming with multiple pretenses. They pretend to be old. They pretend to be in Scotland. They pretend to be remote. They pretend to be sited in green parks. The ideal of the British suburb is a mix of self-told lies, escapism, and easy fantasy. I guess that at the root of this escapism is the true British disease. The conviction that country is superior to city.
Sometimes the village fiction and the bucolic banality are relieved. Sometimes the pursuit of the past is abandoned. But this sort of arty architecture, despite its outdoorsiness and its association with health, has no part to play in the dream hamlet of Middlebrow On Tee. It's like a whiff of reality. It's like tasting a republic after a diet of monarchy. Oh dear.
No, I don't play golf at all. In fact, I don't really think I know of anybody who plays golf. Although, you know, if you go down to the village, you see an awful lot of people wandering around, waitresses, and you think, Uh-huh, yes, they've just come off the golf course. This house used to belong to Dinah Dawes and Aaron Lake, and I first saw this house on breakfast television. And when it came up for sale, I thought, right, we've got to go down and have a look at it. And when we first arrived, we came through the gates, and I thought, oh, this house is a bit Beatrix Potter. But once you come inside, it's totally Hollywood. We used to have an awful lot of people who would just arrive at weekends and congregate outside the gates, and we think, earth are they doing? So we creep outside and stand behind the gates and listen to them. And then we realise they were Diana Dawes' fans. The chap who runs the Diana Dawes fan club, he had written for a number of years on the trot and said, please, could I come down and see the house? So one day I thought, oh, fine, yeah, okay, come. Well, when he arrived, I mean, he was a very, very nice chap. And when he arrived, he was, you know, absolutely, well, what could he say? He was in the house of his idol. And he actually brought a little jar with him and put some water in it from the swimming pool. And apparently he has it now in his bedroom, all labelled up, water from Diana Dawes' swimming pool.
So much for the British film industry. Back to the 19th hole.
The golf clubhouse is, crudely, the castle on the hill. It's the pile at the centre of an estate. At the very least, it's a manor house. These, anyway, are the pretences. The reality of the matter is that golf clubhouses are suburban villas built on an inflated scale. Architecturally, they belong to the first era of motoring, which is why they also resemble roadhouses.
And where there were roadhouses, there were also transport cabs. Zan is golf speak for artisan. Till a few years ago, this quasi-feudal practice of artisan membership was commonplace. It still exists here and there. The idea being that non-officer class members work on the course so many hours per annum in lieu of paying fees. They get their own clubhouse too, commensurate with their status, safely out of sight, hidden away in a time warp where everyone knows his place and forelocks are still tugged. Clubs maintain a way of life where the equation of status with money is not total. Funny handshakes, the right striped tie, these are the important things. But soon, the age-old cry of jumbo G&T, ice and slice twice, will be a thing of the past. Increasingly, money can buy you golf. Golf has come of leisure age, and leisure agers need Lebensraum to swing their niblicks in. They need expanses of artificial green, of chemically enhanced verdure, in which to wear their kit, to bunk off to with their colleagues and pretend they're working.
There can be no doubt that from a pictorial point of view, and probably from an ecological one, the trad golf course is preferable to the prairie wastes of the agricultural industry, which has turned much of this country into an outdoor factory, which has erected factory buildings in former fields, which has whinged for subsidies to pull up hedges, which has produced unusable crops and uneatable meat. Just how much abattoir slurry does one country need? Just how much rapeseed oil?
One might be tempted to say, turn it all over to golf. Let the leisure fetishists have as many courses as they want. Then we'll have to suffer neither the agri-industry's wretched produce nor its dismal landscapes. Of course, it won't come to that. There is no National Union of Golfers, no Institute of Buggy Manufacturers to exert pressure. Golf is as different from that which we've seen so far as the agri-industry is from the vernacular harmonious farms which used to enhance the countryside and which smelled better too. Golf course, do you remember? Of course you do. Golf course, when I was young, I didn't lie to you. New golf is intensive, industrial and has evident affinities with battery farming. And the animals don't necessarily like it. This is industrial golf at its basest level, squeezed between a railway and a motorway in downtown Subtopia.
You do not have to be a member here. You execute a financial transaction, X pounds for Y balls. It is, of course, merely a practice facility. But with its quirky technology and its patently artificial grass, which doesn't even need to be green, no one's fooled by it, and with its repetitive ritual, it seems kind of unearthly. It's more like a colony of the planet Golf than it is like a colony of Scotland. This is, evidently, the fast food end of golf. Instant gratification.
But the posh end of the game that wanted to be a sport and ended up as an industry has also been colonised. Here, a prime piece of the Surrey Cairngorms has been transformed by the technocrats from the planet Golf. The sun rises on Hazelmere's Mount Fuji. The notion of golf as a form of exercise, a good walk spoiled, has been abandoned. More energetic participants in the new golf can still use Shanks's pony. But that doesn't mean they have to do anything so Luddite as carry their clubs.
Good boy. Yeah. The advantages of electric caddy over the old-style Zan caddy, manifold. Visual, obviously. Also, electric caddy is mute. It doesn't answer back. It's obedient. It never makes deprecatory remarks about its master's ineptitude. Furthermore, it doesn't carry round a flask of Asda own brand scotch. Indeed, it represents the vanquishment of everything Scottish about golf. Everything, that is, apart from a Asarka tartan.
The new golf has other qualities to recommend it. The clubhouses no longer stink of school food. We have to learn to call them something other than clubhouses. But this is a meagre matter, and so too is the manner in which these places conduct their social and recreational sides.
What is of moment, even to those of us who've never even lifted a golf stick in our lives, is the environmental, or at least visual, effect of this new golf, this industrial golf. It has created a landscape which is without precedent. Golf design has, a century after the rest of the world, apparently discovered abstraction.
This is a landscape that is devoid of all content, save golfing content. Bunkers full of imported sand, fairways, greens and tees grown from imported grass seed. The fact that it's imported is neither here nor there. I'm not xenophobic about sand or about grass seed. I'm all for free trade in sand and grass. My observations are aesthetic, not mercantile or chauvinistic. This utilitarian landscape is golf's answer to and unfortunate aping of agri-industrial prairie. It refers only to itself. It looks as if, and probably is, computer designed. See those undulations, feel the way they've been tweaked on a screen. Where the old courses played it being parkland, this resembles nothing so much as a cosmetic version of a primitive scape of barrows and tumuli, which may or may not be witting. Probably not. Its only purpose is to satisfy the lust for golf. The old golf gods, who lived in Bracken and Gorse, were gods of compromise. Compromise between the social and the competitive, between town and country, between sport and game. Golf is now polarized. The home counties were ideal for Scottish colonisation because so much of them bore an arboreal resemblance to Scotland.
Anywhere is ideal for colonisation by the Planet Gulf. This is because the Planet Gulf builds exactly the same wherever it goes. It's like systems buildings or portaloos, or like French colonies, where no architectural concessions were made to the subject land. This is the year zero approach to golf. It's as radical and as revolutionary as anything which the mundane game will ever suffer. This is going to be a golf court, a hitting pitch.
Such terrains will very likely encourage golf to reduce itself to a further level of absurdity, one which its advanced amateurs have thus far only dreamed of.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Launch commit. Liftoff. We have liftoff with Apollo 14.
25 seconds.
Scene, Al Shepard becomes the first lunar golfer.
Miles and miles and miles.
Machines.
Now, I do love being out in the fresh air. Anyway, Jonathon, it is Jonathon, isn't it? Lovely
yes,
name, lovely
yes.
name. Over here, over here. Did I tell you about the game I had with Kennedy?
No.
Lynch. Marvellous fella. Anyway, you know, super chaps. I told him about Tommy, you know, Tommy.
Who?
And he said, that reminds me of the time we were playing with Henry Cooper, and Sean Connery, yes. He wears a wig, you know. Yes.
Really?
Anyway, lovely man. Ever met him? Oh, super chap. No, you get on well, really. A smashing player. Anyway, I bogeyed at the 4th, he birdied at the 9th, eagled at the 17th.
Eagled?
And Roger Moore, you must know him, yeah. Bit of a saint. Anyway, we were playing with Roddy Corbett, yeah. Small man, big hit, and we had to give him a couple of shots. Do you know, Roddy spends so much time in the bunker, he gets mail addressed to Hitler.
What's that then?
So do you play the game?
No, I do
not. No, charming. Well, I say a game. It's more than a game, it's a religion. 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 More than a game, it's a religion.